There, buenas. I've been to that one. Yeah. Wait until I go out of the room.
You did the handy modules?
Yeah.
So it's a great test. Let's see what he's up for.
Good, good.
Should be available.
Okay,
I'm ready.
Yes, I'll go and check tonight.
Yeah. So you see slides.com and then FJ Gallery, and then I've got all of them in there.
Okay, cool. Fantastic.
Yeah. So that's the handy modules one.
Nice.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Cool.
Okay.
Yeah. Wi-Fi is not working, but I'm just using the mobile. So.
If it's not, try disconnecting and reconnecting.
I've done that already.
Okay, then, sorry.
It's fine.
Just so many people who are there at the same time with so many different
Yeah,
devices.
It's totally fine. We'll survive.
Okay, you too.
Yeah, thank you very much for checking. Cool. So, yeah, welcome all to the talk. I'm aware that it's the very last one of the day. We're probably tired, we're probably hungry, we're probably many things. Alert might not be one of them. So I try to make it interesting. I mean, feel free really to stop me. There's Q&A at the end, but to be honest, I don't mind being interrupted mid-session to answer anything. So just feel free to ask around. Little bit about me. Some of you already know me, some of you don't. So my name is Fran. I work for Amazee Labs. I usually work Right now I'm working on support and maintenance. I can senior developer, part of that team. Those are my contact details. And basically, I mean, anything, if you just type FJ Gardening on Google, whatever comes out of it, that's where I am. And if it doesn't come on the search, that's because I'm not in there. So, just that. Cool. So, what we're planning to cover today, this is in the track of community and business, so it's not going to be a technical talk at all. But I'm trying to make it Drupal orientated as well, as much as I can. So this is about team leadership, okay, and what is that person's role within a team. And we also try to hook it up to Drupal, and I'm going to be also showing like some real life examples, talking about some old colleagues and things like that. The first thing is why am I really giving this talk? Okay, so first of all, I like sharing. I think if we are over here, if we all use Drupal, there's that sharing part that we all have in common. And I just like talking about my own experiences, talking about what I know, because by doing that, I find that other people talk back, and then I learn, and then I might be able to, tell those people something that they didn't know. So I just like learning all the time, and I like discussing, I like talking, and by talking to other people is the way that I've learned the most. So that's kind of what inspired me to give this talk. A little bit more about myself. So when I started to work, I started as a teacher. So I was teaching kind of MBQ level, so after high school, before uni, that sort of thing, and I was teaching all sort of computing things, so programming, databasing, networking, all that. It's something that I did like a lot, it was really fulfilling. For a few things, one of the things is that I would never finish working, so I would have like 3, 4, 5 hours lessons on that day, then go back home, and I need to do the markings, I need to prepare the lessons, and then it comes the end of the semester when the parents come and meet you. I didn't like really all those parts. But teaching was something that I really enjoyed a lot. But then at some point I was really attracted by, I knew development obviously, I've learned in the uni and I was using my free time, but I wanted to get my hands a bit dirty as well. I don't know, it's not only telling students you gotta do this, you gotta do that, it's doing it myself, facing real challenges, and I'm getting out a bit of the theory level. I started working on PHP, a bit of backend as well, like same framework and other MVC frameworks and all that. But then at some point I was introduced to Drupal. I started working with Drupal 6 in the last days of Drupal 6, so I've been mostly working on Drupal 7 and lately Drupal 8 as well. And then along those years, most of my career as developer has been as in Drupal. And most of that time, I've been growing as a team leader. So I started off in my old place as kind of junior developer, like mid-level developer. And then I was growing and growing and growing. Some of the old people left. And that kind of put me in a spot in which I needed to be. I mean, we also had a culture in there of hiring a lot of junior people for several reasons. So I was in a spot in which I needed to actually teach all those junior guys, I needed to mentor them, I needed to spend a lot of time with them. And that was cool. I mean, it's on one hand, as I said, I did enjoy teaching, but I didn't like certain parts of teaching. And then I did enjoy development, and that's kind of where everything connects together again. So I could still spend some time with people, see them grow, see them improve, but also I was as well working as a developer, and it was more a real-time situation, sort of, day by day, as opposed to when you are teaching, which is, this is happening, we're gonna fix it, let's sit down and do it. Okay, now I'm just senior developer. I don't hold the role of team leader anymore, just because I moved to Amazing. But to be honest, I will mention it at the very end of the presentation. I still do the same. I'm not co-team leader, but I still spend time with juniors. I sit down with them, we do pair programming, all these sort of things. So yeah, it's kind of cool. So we're going to be talking a lot of things about that journey, okay? What my thoughts are. It doesn't mean that that's the way to go. That's what my thoughts are. So I'm more than open to, as I said before, opinions, different points of view, or these sort of things. So the role of a team leader, I like it. But if we would need to put it, it really depends on the size of the company, obviously. But on a normal situation, we would have management at the top, we would have all the team at the bottom somehow, and then we would have project managers, project owners. Those are the people who are usually in touch with the client. And then we have the team leader kind of in between, like linking, like passing the information from the project manager on product owner. It might even be involved with the client or not. But then that's kind of the challenge is to lead the team towards achieving the project, the end goal, really. I want to make a differentiation between management and leadership. If you say I put management and I put team leader, because I really think that they are very different. A manager, the way I see it, is a person up there, and this role is far beyond that. I don't even think of that. A leader is somebody that has to be inspiring, that has to be human, has to be exactly the same level as a junior person, because if the moment that they see you above them, they will be reluctant to talk to you, they will be reluctant to approach to you, they will have fears that they won't share with you. So I really think that part of the role of a team leader is a lot of attitude. And basically there is a difference between trying to lead a team as opposed to trying to manage a team. When you are leading, I think of TV shows and old movies and all these sort of things. When they go to war, the leader, that's the one that goes the first, whereas the team stays behind. Okay, so that's management versus leadership. You really need to get your hands dirty and be in the middle of the situation and all these sort of things. I put in there that it's usually a developer, just because it makes sense. It doesn't need to be all the time. It really depends on the context of the company. But it usually makes sense for it to be a developer. I'm not saying backend, frontend, site builder. I'm just saying developer, because he's more in contact with the team. Okay, his or her role is towards the team, really. And one of the key things that I think is the most important, and probably, in that sense, you are exposed. When you are leading, you are exposed. Everybody is looking at you, especially the juniors. Okay. So you really need to lead by example, and that might be really topical, really silly sentence to say, but that's hard to achieve, because leading by example all day, every day, it can be tricky. Sometimes you get lazy, you get bad days, you get all sorts of things. Between the skills that I think they are important is communication. Regardless of your accent, you just need to pass the message across. It doesn't matter how, so long as it gets in there. You need to be organized, but yeah, I've put in bold the ones that I really think are key in here. You've got to be approachable. That's a very challenging one. We'll see later on that as a team leader, you're going to have probably more pressure than any other team member, just because they're going to, because of your seniority or position, they're going to try to make you more accountable, and you're going to be more involved with the budget, whereas maybe a junior developer hasn't got a clue about what budget is or the time implications. So it is a real challenge to be approachable. If somebody asks for your help, you've got to be there, and that could create stress sometimes. At the moment, I'm working remote, but as I said, even if I'm not team leader, it doesn't change that much. There are some times in which people just slack me and it's like, yeah, let's just talk. And we just video chat and yeah, have a go at it. And I think that's really important.
And it's what will make developers grow as well, because they won't be afraid to ask the silly question. Once they ask it, they will learn it, and that means that next week they will know about it, and that means that in 2 weeks' time, if maybe another junior has that issue, maybe that person can help. So eventually, having done that investment at the beginning on your time, it will invest on the rest of the team. Confidence, I think it's important. Respectful, and again, like as a team leader, you can have all sorts of people in your team. And sometimes you just need to shut up on your opinion or whatever. I don't know. You've got to be careful with that, really. It's all about respect. I always say that I'm more than open to listen to any opinion, so long as you are open to listen to my opinion. So if there's a culture of good communication, use it. Otherwise, just be careful. And if you are not willing to do all these kind of things, probably you are not willing, or maybe you're going to have a harder time. Okay, you can still be a team leader, but I think, as I said before, attitude really makes a difference with this role, in the sense of enjoying it. Okay, you can be a team leader, a really good team leader, and not enjoy it. You can be a crappy team leader and enjoy it, and that will make you a happier worker. Okay, and I think the happiness of each and every employee is key, even if you are not the best position for that. Okay, I might be, I know that along all these years and still today, I do really things that could be done differently, better, but I enjoy, and I have an open mind to learning and all these sort of things, and it's kind of the way I'm enjoying it is what makes me keep on going as well. Being fair, okay, so credit when it's due and all these sort of things, so you really need to... again, we're talking about people, we're not talking Drupal, we're not talking about any technology, so you really got to be careful in not being unfair towards somebody just because you don't like that person or anything like that. So, yeah, that's important, integrity. Influential, I think some of the things come with time as well. Delegation, that's key. For me, that was a real challenge. I started off, as I told you before, as a developer. I was, besides a more senior person, I was a junior at that time. And then at some point, I started to have more and more responsibilities, and then all those senior people went away. So that was everything on me. When you know the systems, when you know the project well, it is really hard to let go of it and trust somebody that you know is gonna make mistakes, which is normal. It's okay. I did my mistakes as well at the beginning, and they have to do it in order to grow. So that delegation, delegate your job or a task into somebody is something that you really need to learn how to do. But it's really important as well, because otherwise you would end up doing everything, and you would be like micromanaging those people. So it's kind of important to learn that as well. And what happens when you delegate is that then you need to facilitate. It's not just, here it is, just do it. I chat with you tomorrow. It's like, okay, here it is, you have to do this task. Maybe you can find resources here, here, here. And maybe you can find an example of how to do this in this project and in that other project. So that's important as well. It's, again, we're trying to make people grow. So it's important to give them the resources. I always the approach that I've always taken, that might have been right or might have been wrong, is I try to be to the junior developers what I would have liked to have when I was a junior. Okay, I was lucky enough to have really good people, and I took a lot of the things that I do from them. But I was unfortunate enough as well to be thrown at projects without any sort of background, without anything. I was hard to really ask for help and this sort of thing. So I really try to facilitate as much as possible. I think it's important. You need to negotiate, especially when it comes to that side of things. Okay, we'll talk about it in a bit. And then probably the most important to me is honesty. If you mess up, you really need to admit it. If you said something stupid and you realize later on, just say this, be human. It doesn't matter, again, you're a leader, you're not a manager, you're not I think it's easier to get the respect from other people if you're honest, if you're open. If you say, I don't know, somebody asks you something, I have no idea. I can look it up for you, we can look it up together, we can just try to do it together. If sometimes you mess up, then go home, talk to the wife or talk to your friends, and then you realize that you made a mistake, it's important to go on the following day and apologize. Might be stupid, but it's hard to apologize for some people. So I really think that honesty is again key. It's coming back to what I said at the beginning, we're trying to lead. And in order to lead, you need to be at the same level, okay? If you are going to battle, I mean, I probably don't like that example of battle, but when you go to battle, you all go together. So when you are leading, you need to lead with the rest of the people. And you need to be one more. We're talking is like, do you that this role is usually a developer? Do you need to be an expert developer? I think that helps, but I think that's not everything at all. I think it's really more about attitude, because again, maybe I don't know, but I'm gonna sit down with you and we're gonna find out together. Helps more than knowing what it is and then not facilitate that to the person. I have had that. I was very frustrating. When I was starting with Drupal, my beginning was a bit bumpy because of that. I mean, I didn't have the support that I should have inside the company, and that made it hard. It was a really bumpy start. Then over time, things got better, people changed, and all that. I don't think that this really, you don't need to be an expert developer, you just need to be there, help, and all the other things that I just mentioned before. Then it's important, things that maybe any other person of the team, or maybe more junior people don't think about, is you really need to think of which approach am I going to take to project. So as a team leader, you usually need to think of that beforehand, because depending on the skills of the team, could be that we have mostly front-enders, we have mostly back-enders, we have site builders, but none of them. We might have just all newbies to Drupal. What do we do in those cases? And then not only skill set-wise, I mean, do they know the technology or which area do they focus on? Is it like, what's their experience? Is it their first job? Are they coming out of another job, or they are experienced developers? So, we focus on this question later on when I try to hook it up to Drupal. But again, that's something that you gotta think of when you are in that position, okay? And before even starting a project. And then what are the challenges? So if you see, I literally copy-paste that first line. So to me, most of the times, most of the challenges have come from the left side. But as a team leader, you also have a lot of challenges on the right side. So the team itself is a challenge. You have a myriad of characters, a myriad of skills, a myriad of willingness to learn or to listen or to anything. And then on the left, you've got management, and you've got project managers, owners, and clients as well. You might be lucky enough maybe not to be too involved in clients, but still management, product owners, they add an extra pressure, and for example, some of the key things that I've been facing over the years has been first performance. So, and again, we're talking of a team leader. Is it just your performance? It is your performance, but it's the performance of a team. If you are having a team of juniors, they're gonna blame you. But if we're going over budget, over time, they're just gonna blame you because it's supposed that you are leading them, you are experienced, you should know the drill, blah 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 blah. So you've got a challenge in there. The second one is accountability, which is kind of similar. Again, it's your own accountability on the team. Something goes wrong, who's to blame in here? Are we going to blame the junior that just started working with Drupal 2 months ago? It's not fair, you should have taught him better. Something like that. So those challenges, those are situations that you are going to find. And then probably, the last two go together most of the times, time and budget. What's the time that you've given for a project? And what's the budget? Many times as a team leader, I always try to stay away from money. I always say, even when they start telling me numbers, it's like, don't tell me the number. It's like, because I don't care. The number you are putting it, and you are, that's your decision. I'm not going to say whether this project is 10K, 50K, 100K. Because I can tell you about time, what I think could be. So I think that was, that has always been a challenge. But by sticking to it, in my case at least, it has worked. I refuse to talk money. Because I am on the other side of the thing, okay? You want to meet with the client, you want to deal with the client. I can tell you how long I think something is going to take. 3 days, 4 days. Are you willing to absorb part of that as training? So be. Do you want to charge every single hour? So be. I'm telling you what the time could be. And usually when we're talking about time, I'm not even going to tell you 5 days. I'm going to tell you this might be between 5 to 10 days. Why 5 to 10 days? We're talking double. It really depends. It's like we're talking best case, worst case. So on that, I think, again, coming, it is a challenge. It's like we were talking before about kind of the attitude towards the team. You need to be close. You need to be honest. You need to be fair, respectful with these sort of things. But at the same time, you need to be harsh as well, in the sense of not harsh in a bad way, you know. I'm there because I am somebody, okay, because I have some experience. So if I'm telling you that this is probably going to take 10 days, if you don't want to listen to me, it's going to be your decision, but I told you 10 days. And that is a challenge. That's not easy to say to a boss. That's not easy to say to somebody who is over you. But if you don't say that, then you're exposing yourself. Then you will be accountable. If you never say, I thought it was going to be 10 days, and then they agree to 5, and then it takes 10, they say, ah, oh, it's 10 days, why? I told you. Okay, so that's kind of the key. And that's, again, this is in the challenging area. All this is the uncomfortable part. All this, you can make it comfortable and nice. But you don't need to be scared of this. If they are relying on you, if somehow you are put into that position, it's because you've done something right to be in that position. So you shouldn't be afraid to talk to management, to talk to a product owner. If a client comes back with a silly request, just try to talk them out of it. Just try to tweak it a bit so that we still achieve part of what they want, but we do it in a way that is achievable in a realistic time and budget. More challenges, bad days. I mean, it's my kid has woken up 3 times tonight. I've been up since 5. My kid is crumpy, and I'm even crumpier. And then I need to go to work to find more crumpy people. It all comes back to really, those things happen, it will happen. I mean, we're all human. At the beginning, I always try to hide it. At the end, I was just hoping as a book. It's like, it's been awful. If I say something that I shouldn't today, please, I apologize in advance. So again, it comes back to honesty. Again, we're talking about challenges. That is a challenge. Then some more challenges, and the last two, I think they are really important, and these two, they are really fulfilling, if you get them right. One is keeping developers engaged. So we were talking before about juniors, and I've been mentioning many times junior, but what if you're leading more experienced developers? I mean, I've had in my team people with 10, 20 years experience, whereas I only had 5. That's the challenge in itself, like, earn the respect of that people, keeping engaged. It could be tricky, but I think it's possible. I mean, you need to find ways. I've always had regular catch-ups with them. I try to say, okay, what do you want to do, and what can we do within our constraints of the company?
It's much harder when you're in a company structure that has plenty of projects in parallel, and that developers have to switch from project to project. Did you find any situation like that to be able to keep them really engaged and invested into the project that you're trying to run?
Yeah, right. Yeah, I know what you mean. So in that sense, the approach that I used to take is I really fought for having regular catch-ups with the developers. Again, I was honest to them. So I would ask somebody, where do you want to go? What do you want to focus on? I really want to focus on backing. I want to do symphony, to parade. I'm going to tell them, okay, if the opportunity comes, I make the most, I try my best to have you do it. If it doesn't, then it's completely out of my control. What can we do? Training. Do we have a training budget or not? If we have a training budget, can we convince management to get them to do a symphony course? So for example, something I did...
So what you're suggesting is that we can offer to developers within the team the possibility of choosing their own staffing in terms of the different parts of the developments that need to be done on different kinds of projects.
Yeah, I first tried that. I mean, maybe I've been lucky, but I found out that this... I've always found a mix of some of them want backend, some of them want frontend, whereas some of them want just to do a bit of everything. And in that sense, it has worked out. And it has given me very, very valuable information when working on those multiple projects. Yeah. That's pretty much all the context that I've been working on always, like many projects going on at the same time.
Right.
And it gives me precisely the tools, the information that I need to allocate people to projects.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, the only way that I could find that out was by meeting with the developers regularly. I always kept logs of it, and we always used to come back to it and say, okay, 2 months ago you told me this, what have we done in these 2 months? I haven't had any backend project. Okay, then look for training. Try to find a course, try to find a certification, try to find a conference, go for it. Maybe we can work that way. If, I mean, at the end of the day, if we don't have certain projects, if I want to get better at React, but we don't have any React projects, the only way is to do it in another way, okay, which is not a project. And then, yeah, the last challenge is really career progression, which is kind of close to keeping developers engaged, because when they are engaged, then we try to make their own way. And then career progression, again, I talk about your own career progression and your team. I think it's important to really see where they want to go, because that will make it easier to allocate them to this or to that or to other things. I will keep them happier. If they're happier, they will keep on working for longer and they will keep on growing, and things kind of will work out better. And then think of your own progression as well. It's like, again, it's you gotta question yourself, am I happy in this role? Am I having too much pressure? And does the pressure outweigh the other nice things that the role has? So yeah, you gotta keep it honest with yourself and see whether you want to do it or not.
Career progression is a little bit overlapped with the management, no? In our company, it's the way that it's done. It's like the project managers, like, or managers at a higher level will have like interviews with the staff on a regular basis and ask them, where would you like to go? Functional, development, testing, steps like that. But is it, you think it should still be the responsibility of the team leader?
At least in the part, I mean, obviously not with everybody. Maybe if we're talking, probably the team leader could be, because I think, the way I think is that the team leader is the person that is closer to the team.
Yeah.
Usually POs or management, they won't talk regularly to developers, so they won't know that.
Yeah.
So if a developer tell me, I want to be project manager, then I could just just pass that information and say to management or to any other PO, this person wants to be that.
Yeah.
What can we do? And then forget about it. But I think that the team leader in this case, when you are on a development team, is the entry point of the information. After that, it can be spread too.
It's very much into the attitude to get close, very close with your team and establish this kind of relationship.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was trying to focus on that first part. I really think it's the key, and it's what you can enjoy and what they can really, yeah, you can be a group together.
Right.
I want to bring it, obviously, when all in DrupalCon, and so I want to bring all that a bit into the Drupal world. That's a lot of information, we don't need to go through all of it, but obviously I'm not going to say too much about why Drupal and not WordPress. I think we're all here for a reason, okay? It's got a great foundation, it's got extensibility, community, so I'm not going to go too much into that. But if we want to focus into, okay, if I were talking to a managing director, PO, PM, so we can always say it's open source, or maybe when dealing, sorry, those roles, when dealing with clients, an argument that you can use is it's open source, there's loads of information out there, so it's easy to move between agencies. So you're not really saying, I'm going to do this, and you're going to be hooked with me forever. So that's a good argument. As a team leader, when using Drupal, so I think it's really good for mentoring and coaching. So there are other frameworks that might not be as good in the sense of resources, and in the sense that you can really architect the project in multiple ways. If you're using the same framework, good luck. I mean, it's awesome once you know it, but going through the documentation is hard, and it really focuses the architectural approach of a project in a certain way. Whereas with Drupal, we can always go more towards custom modules, and site building, all these sort of things. So I really think that Drupal offers a little bit on that. And then, yeah, when talking about leading by example again, so how Drupal how are you doing the things when you are working? Are you doing them in the Drupal way? Are you hacking away? So yeah, you gotta be careful with that. And then as a developer, what you will find with Drupal is that obviously we have an initial learning curve, whether that is Drupal 7, 8, or whichever version.
It's very big.
Yeah, it's a steep at the beginning. It's much harder than it could be any other, like CMS or like WordPress or maybe Laravel, things like that. They are easy to pick up and you have loads of things. But once you know a little bit the drill, it's very flexible. Something that I really like about Drupal is that, yeah, you've got those separation of backend, frontend, side building. I mean, if some of you were in my previous talk, like handy modules, you can build loads and loads and loads of sites just clicking away without coding a single line. You can build a whole website. That was unthinkable a few years ago. Many more years ago. I mean, older than I want to be. So it's flexible. It's got a lot of modules. It's got a huge community, so that helps a lot as a developer. Again, do you need to be an expert Drupal developer? No way. You don't have to at all. And then, if you remember, I told you that I will come back to this approach to projects. So, in that sense, for me, the way I've been approaching in all these years, when developing with Drupal, so how do you engage experienced developers? Make them code. Okay? They were excited about coding Drupal 7 modules, and they are even more excited now to code Drupal 8 modules. It's way more challenging, but that's part of keeping them engaged. So whatever is in the project that could need custom code, send it to them, send it their way. Okay? Even if sometimes it's over engineering. I mean, so long as you stick to the budget and the time, a developer, I mean, I have found situations in which people have been willing to work on their own time, just because they wanted to learn how to code Drupal 8 modules. Okay, it was a big change from Drupal 7 to 8. They really wanted to learn, and they said, okay, we could do this, but maybe we can do this custom module, and okay, go for it. That could be a way to keep them engaged. What if we have just the opposite strategy? Like just first job, I don't know my way around Drupal. I would say completely the opposite. Don't let them code. Don't let them write a line of code, because each line that they write, it is a potential point of failure of the project. So in that sense, with junior developers, it's really easy to work with Drupal, because they can achieve loads, and that gives them really good sense of achievement, because they've been able to build a whole website using a tool. Just by installing modules and all that. And that's cool. I mean, we don't have that with all the frameworks. In some of the frameworks, you are forced to code, whereas with Drupal, you could get away without it. And then if we're in a situation in between, we can also always build. I do some site building, coding. So when I used to work with developers, I always told them, it was mostly about content types, because some of them, they could just go crazy, start creating content types, and end up the site with 20 content types. That was awful to maintain. And I told them, keep it simple, keep it easy. So my point is, what I'm trying to get at is, again, as a team leader, you can lead them in a specific direction. You can try to keep them engaged in a different part of the project.
How do you start with people, graduate developers, people who know zero Drupal? How do you start with them? Do you start with them on the project?
So usually, I mean, that would really depend on management and how willing to invest time on them. Usually when you take a junior, you're making a commitment to train somehow because you know their lack of experience. So I've always pushed for a few weeks of pure training. Having the first 2-3 weeks of pure training, I've given them the resources. I go in this Drupalize mini series, just go through it, go in this blog post. I'm even trying to set them dummy projects. Or maybe if I see that they are very easy to do tickets, just try to give them that. But I think that, for a graduate, the very first experience that you've got with Drupal is key, because that could be confidence, and then I will make them work harder towards getting to know better Drupal. Obviously, it's not everything down to me. If I say to management, I want 3 weeks for this developer just to be trained, they can say, no, I want them in production straight away. Then, again, part of the challenge we were talking before, you really need to talk out your mind and say, that's not a good idea, they're going to mess up. And there's nothing we can do because it's not even their fault.
Basically, there's no choice.
Yeah.
It's either you develop it yourself or.
Exactly. So I think it's really talking about them. Talking a bit more about challenges. So if you say I've written custom. So is time a challenge? You need to really choose whether you write something custom or not. If that can be custom theming, or it can be using Bootstrap out of the box as it is. It could be on a module, like do we want the Salesforce-based integration or do we want to write something for Salesforce? We're talking budget, is the same. So most of the times, whether a project will go over time, whether a project will go over budget, it really depends whether how much custom code you do. But then it's on the other side to keep developers engaged and to keep to improve. You really need to start doing custom things. It's the only way. If you don't do modules, you don't get better at doing modules. I think, go.
1 minute.
1 minute. Wasn't it until 5?
We can't go over time.
You can if you want to,
I thought it was until 5, and that's what I was counting on. Are we okay until 5?
Yeah.
6 minutes. Cool.
Go ahead.
I trust my employee. All right, so I just wanted to talk to you briefly about some people. Whoa, that's no internet. So there are nice photos in there of those people. But because I'm hooked into my mobile, they are not loading for whatever reason. But anyway, we've got Alex, we've got Joel, and we've got Nick. The three of them were actual team members. So Alex's background was more PHP developer. So he started as a junior, it wasn't his first job. And his main struggle was that he wanted to really understand everything. So it took him forever to really go through any ticket because he was actually reading the code of the modules. So how did Drupal help in his case? Trust other people's code, trust the community, trust your peer developers. You don't really need to understand it. I'm telling you that this does that, trust it. You don't need to go through it and see how many variables or whatever, just use it. And he also helped learn good patterns on there. So he improved, obviously, in practicality. And what is he now? Just his technical lead of UI. So in his case, it was a total shift from he started backend and now he's doing mostly frontend. Joel, she did sound engineering, no programming whatsoever. She did a few, little bit of programming in some math modules, but no programming. So she started as an intern. And then she struggled a little bit more in backend and server management. So in that sense, I mean, we realized that straight away and we kept her away from that. So how did Drupal help in this case? Because she could focus on the front end side of Drupal. That's where we put her in. And she's amazing. I mean, she's really good at it. It took her some time, but by focusing just on that side, we didn't force her into learning things that were beyond her capabilities. And then, yes, improving on that I said, and now she's a Drupal front-end developer. And then Nick, so he did computer science. It was his first job, but he had a really good base. So he started as a junior developer, and his struggles were mainly budget. He was a perfectionist.
He wanted to do everything up to the last detail. He would spend hours and hours and hours of his own time just working on a project. And that's no good either. I mean, as a team leader, you really need to tell them, first job, you are super enthusiastic, okay, great, but go easy because you are going to just burn out very soon. And you also need to keep it practical. I need to be within the constraint. If you always go over budget, then yeah, you're not going to learn to work within those constraints, which I think is important. So Drupal helped in this case to follow a simple approach to some projects. As I said, instead of creating 20 content types, can you get away with three and use paragraphs? Then do it. Easy. And then he improved a lot in, yeah, knowing the complexity of tasks, stepping out and see the whole picture and thinking about it, which I think is important. And especially, yeah, when coding was involved. And where he is now, so he jumped into digital consultancy and now he's Drupal developer again. He wanted to do development. So that was it. I mean, as I said at the very beginning, the team leader skills are not really technical. They are important, but they are not key. In order to make developers grow, you really need to know them. You need to know what they want and also know the context of the company and all that. How does Drupal help with the flexibility to, yeah, follow multiple approaches? There are multiple parts of Drupal that they could touch on. The community is, we're here for a reason. And then, yeah, obviously the path of each person is unique. People and technology can help them shape it, but yeah, it's up to really people how they shape that. And I really think I told you all this at the beginning. I'm not in leader anymore, but to me nothing has changed. I'm part of a team. We are like 7-8 people. We have juniors, we have more experienced people, and I just try to help whenever I can, just because that's what I like. So I believe that's it. All the slides are available in there, so just feel free to take them. Any more questions in the last minute? Then thank you all, and let's go.
You probably already heard that there's a social event tonight. It's our surprise. It's at the Lexington Toddy Major pub. We've taken over the pub, and there's thousands of pounds behind the bar from Frank, who is the sponsor for you. If you want to go there.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, especially when you throw Drupal to the equation.
Yeah.
I've been in Drupal development for 12 years, and I haven't been able to solve this problem. So it's constantly, you know, complicated, and I have to try to think of a way to simplify it a little bit. Yeah. The problem is that if you're looking to hire trained people, the price is going to be like this.
Yeah.
If you're looking to hire juniors, then your learning curve plus the time that you spend training.
That's the reason why I mentioned the challenges is like, right. Because yeah, in my previous company, they really wanted that. They wanted to hire juniors just because of the price, because they didn't want to pay that.
Right.
But yet then. Then I need it, to be honest. It's like, you cannot produce high quality things in middle time, in middle budget with that kind of people.
Exactly.
So yeah, we really needed to get to a middle point, middle ground in which they acknowledge the complexity.
Besides, it doesn't guarantee that these developers will not leave once you've trained them.
So you keep having this kind of never-ending problem.
Yeah, I mean, it's, at the end of the day, I mean, it's just everyone they've been talking about people, and people in that sense don't evolve as quick as technology.
Right.
So,